I would be inviting the panelists and the panel members to have a discussion on fire safety, why fire safety is important, why do we require fire safety and fire, you know, fire information right on top of our priority when where we live, work and play. So this should be there, and what should be the way forward, what are the current scenarios. So that we would be dwelling upon lot many information, data, insights with these professionals who are there, and they would be coming up with their thoughts and ideas and so many things. So we were really looking forward to listen to their perspectives as well. So before the panelists, I would like to invite the moderator, architect Rahul Mehta, who is there with us and who would be moderating this session on fire safety with the panel members. And he is a senior associate at PG Patki and Architects, and he is very immensely professional and very experienced professional, and has done lot many projects all over India in the field of residential, commercial and townships, hotel, malls and everywhere. So he is the right person, I think, to moderate this session, and we would really love to hear him out. Sir, please, the stage is all yours. Thank you. A big round of clap for him. Architect Rahul Mehta.
Hi guys. Slightly overwhelming introduction, but thanks a lot. So fire safety has always been a center of a lot of debate, and it's extremely critical to most of our discussions. Most of the architects here, facade consultants and other professionals, vendors, do realize that it is mostly the center of our discussions when we conceptualize a project or we are looking at the open spaces and how we go about setting out a project. So it's very integral to the process itself, and it has always been. Over a period of time, in today's day and age, our cities have grown rapidly. And I think Dr. Rangale pointed out that, you know, density is a big challenge. And as someone said, that a number of high-rises are coming across. Add to that a lot of mixed developments, or mixed-use developments, where multiple typologies are actually within the same complex and within the same building. These things, not only like Dr. Rangale said, are actually part and parcel of today's time. And therefore, a debate like this kind of becomes even more relevant. More importantly, he even touched upon you know, the fire at Grenfell in London, or a lot of the fires that have happened in our city, the fires that have happened in Delhi and wherever else. Most of these are fresh in our minds, and we all know probably one or two examples that we ourselves have probably looked at or talked about over the last few months or maybe the last year. Awareness has increased, like he said rightly, but at the same time, how do we raise the awareness? So a seminar like this kind of leapfrogs and helps us look at various standpoints, and standpoints from the perspective of design, from the perspective of the person who's actually in charge of fighting fire, from the perspective of vendors who are giving us a lot of wonderful materials. So let's just move ahead and take on this panel discussion. It gives me great privilege to introduce all our panelists. To start with, we introduce Dr. Rangale again, and he's a champion. We already know he's our chief fire officer. Dr. Rangale, please. Guys, a round of applause again for him. We also have noted architect, very well-known group, the director of Sankalpan. Please introduce and let's bring in Mr. Shidish Lime. Noted architect Ranjan Goregaonkar from GA Designs, and we had a very, very fruitful discussion with Dr. Rangale before the event started. So guys, we'll get on with this discussion. Doctor, you gave a very nice presentation right now, and I think you probably nipped half of my questions in the bud. So I don't know what I have to ask you.
That's the reason I said, like, no, I think we can hear it like this. Or my presentation is the answer for everything, whatever. And actually, I do have a bit of a time issue. So anybody, as far as we are concerned, anybody wanted to
We can have a quick session with Dr. Rangdale and probably direct some questions to him in terms of what we would want to ask him.
Yeah, so first of all, I want to say it's a great privilege being around this panel and being invited here at the Chief Fire Officer right next to me. So it's a great honor. As an architect, you know, when we plan our buildings, we plan it with the DCR in mind, and then we plan it with the firefighting regulations. I mean, that is of prime importance, because if your building does not fall within those parameters, you will not be able to do, you will not get your approval. So we start off with thinking about, you know, the access of the fire engine and where and will the turning radius be right, have we done the right calculations, everything we do. And we do it very seriously, I think. And I also think, like, because I've got this opportunity to talk on this platform, I think I'm so inspired by Dr. Rangdale that I think I just want to tell every architect that you should design a building keeping in mind the fire regulations, yes, but you should also keep in mind that you are designing it for human beings who are going to live there, and their safety should be most important. So please don't compromise on any kind of rules, and understand that you are doing this for the people and for somebody who is actually living, going to live in that building. So you are, it's your responsibility to make sure, you know, that your building is correct. When you go to the Chief Fire Officer, he should say, you know, that you've designed this very well, because of this design, you know, we will be comfortable tomorrow if there is a problem, or if we have to come there to fight the fire, our job will become easier. So as an architect, I think it is very, very important that we look at it from that point.
Sure.
There are other questions, but I think I'll give.
Yeah.
So you would like to add something to that about architect's role?
What he just said.
I'm not going to be a very specific, I'm going to be a very kind of a generic in this. Constitution of India build on what? The laws build on what? Logic.
Yes.
The logic behind constitution or whatever laws we have for here together. I'm not talking about the constitution of India, I'm talking about the constitution of human being. If that would have been not there, we would have been the same way like a monkeys.
Yes.
Right? It's a logic, okay? Anywhere the logic plays. And the logic is, when you have this, happy, keep on smiling. Everything gets sorted out.
He's touched upon a very important point. Barring rules and regulations, as designers and developers, we all also need to probably look at logic in terms of fire safety. And sir, from that standpoint, fire drills, audits, should they be made more mandatory or should be more voluntary, or something which should happen every year? And maybe pre-designed egress routes, as architects, if we can define in gathering spaces for these same events to happen, probably can help this cause.
I think Rahul, what you were saying is very important, because when we design buildings, we take into consideration all kinds of firefighting equipment. You know, we do a lot of planning and everything about it. But once the building is made, I don't think actually the residents are even, you know, are really aware, or even if they do, it's last on their priority list to, you know, learn about whatever infrastructure has been made in the building to fight fire, and the reasons why a design has been made in a particular way. Like, for instance, you do a residential building, you plan it, you leave 6 meters, 9 meters all around so that the fire engine can access the building. But within months, people put grills on their windows. I understand it's a actual problem, because there are accidents which happen. There are accidents which have happened. But, sir, I just wanted to ask you this question, actually, which was like bothering me. When we make a new building and when people make grills, then isn't this purpose defeated of creating the whole project with firefighting rules and parameters in mind?
Actually, this is also one of the challenging situations for us. Number of times we went over there because of the grill, because it is a is a nick in time, okay? If somebody is stuck and if we, there are numerous incident what we saw is like, it was very easy for somebody to escape also, but because of tenderness of a grill.
Yeah.
In fact, yesterday's fire in Delhi, they put a latches where they cannot open and then people died near the windows. Security and safety always are enemies. I want open space, security want it closed. So we always urge, and in fact there are public appeal. Okay, you wanted to have a grill? Openable at least. That's one thing. The second thing about like, you know, fire auditing is compulsory under Maharashtra Life and Fire Safety Act 2006
right.
or 2008. It is mandatory, required to have to be certification from the licensing agency and which has to be submitted to us. But this is not happening.
It's not being enforced.
Yeah, but it is being enforced by us. So more than like, you know, last 6 months, initially all this inspection and all that were decentralized. Now I took it and more than 57 prosecutions got launched in 6 months. How many electricity and water is being sold? Now what happened in a hot time also we understand, like, now we really require to have a danda. Okay, so that is also one of the awareness. Sometimes it is a negative impact, but negative impact creates more awareness in our Indian society. So we are doing on our front, and then message should go from your side also.
Yeah.
And let's see how it goes.
So should it be made mandatory, say every 3 years or every 5 years or every year?
No, it is mandatory.
Like
every 6 years.
Of a building must come to you and get the audit.
Yeah, that's the reason we are collecting whole database. We are putting into a system orientation. Listen, there is one thing I'm just asking you.
Yes.
You have a car, okay? You don't have a license and you drive. RTO is going to come to your house and ask you to.
Correct, you're right.
It's the same thing. You have own house.
The logic.
You don't take care of your own safety. Law is there.
Correct.
And then something happens, you blame it to somebody. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
So it's simple. You wanted to have a car, you have either have a license. When you do the accident, you go into the jail. Finish.
Absolutely. Chitrit, you want to jump in on this?
No, so I think some very valid points being made over here. So my take is, I'm going to add a bit of a, what do you say, an abstract angle to this.
Sure.
In addition to the logic science and all the experience and all that, there is something called a situational awareness. Yeah. It's all of us, you know, human beings, regardless of whoever you may be, you know. The human mind has been evolved in such a manner that it knows the innate danger. Yeah. So the intuition really plays a big role in terms of in terms of the way the planning approach works of sorts. So typically when we kind of look at the design approach, now for example, if you are sitting in this place, you know, if there should be an incident here, you definitely know which direction you're supposed to run. Absolutely. So basically that situational awareness, you know, this awareness in terms of watching things en route and how typically people behave, you know, understanding all of that is very, very important as a precursor before you even start the designing process. Now, we spoke about, the growing heights of the building, the crazy densities with which the cities are, certain parts of the cities are getting built.
Right.
That's part and parcel of the ballgame. You know, that, you know, you or me or any layperson does not have a control on it in terms of, you know, it always going to be a demand and supply kind of a situation. Now, in that supply situation, how as an architect or how as a responsible citizen, are we going to deal with it? And as beautifully said by him, the building has to fight the fire. And you know, they should basically come in where our efforts or the building's efforts are going to typically end. So in the current scenario, when the fetish for superlatives is not ending, you know, I want to build the tallest, I want to build the biggest, I want to build the largest flow plates, I want to have crazy number of amenities. So there are multiple asset classes which are coming into picture. So having that understanding as to how that building and how the occupants, the permanent occupants as well as the floating occupants are going to kind of typically reciprocate within that building. So intuition as a part of the design has to be demonstrated by an architect. That's going to be something which is, yep, is vitally important.
I think it's very important. It's a good point.
Yeah. And third point that I wanted to make was in terms of obviously, so whenever we, so standards, right? So there is an NBC, there are local bylaws, and there are countless number of smaller subsets and sets. The approach that we typically take, or the tendency, is to always adopt the least
path of least resistance.
At our design processes, the integrated approach is to actually adopt whichever is most stringent.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that please always should be the case. Yeah. So we typically present this to our client as a comparative analysis, that this is what the local bylaws is, this is what the NBC regulate. NBC is a larger framework. It cannot tell us, for example, the city of Mumbai will probably have a far evolved set of fire norms compared to any other, second or tier three city over here. Now, if you probably want to supersede that, there are codes like NFP and stuff like that, with quite a lot of multinationals coming into picture, they wanting to follow, their own codes, which are far more evolved, evolved from the point of view of technology, from the point of view of the amazing sample field that they have seen in their own, the data gathering that we've seen probably the glimpse of certain data gathering. I would like to definitely see the major causes of fire and things like that, where we as an architect so how many fires are attributable to, let's say, the wrong material selection, how many fires are attributable to not providing staircases diagonally opposite, or means of egresses, the adequacy of means of egresses, and so on and so forth. So I think as an approach point of view, one, counting on the situational awareness, the design has to be intuitive. A person should know before he even walks into the space that this is where my egress or my safety net is going to be. And second part is basically always follow whatever is more stringent without compromising there, because fire life safety equipment or measures are something which you cannot augment later on. You can augment toilet blocks, you can augment air conditioning equipment, you can augment anything else, but adding, let's say, additional fire escape staircase or a route, or increasing the width of the passages are physically going to be not possible when the building goes into the commissioning. So these are the two kind of major points that I would like to place on the table.
I think you put in two, three very good ones there. One is typology of materials that are used, be it for the facade or be it for whatever you do inside the building. The other is that there are going to be challenges which we are going to kind of have to live up to, such as say the high-rise buildings. So do you see any particular challenges that architects like us should probably take into consideration, especially for high-rises?
Actually, no building is dangerous. If this building doesn't have anything, okay, and you build it and hand over, that building is not dangerous. We make it dangerous. The linings, nobody think about the interior part, what polyurethane foam is going to have, what happened to the polyurethane foam if it is on a fire. And day by day what is happening is how we are increasing the load. Simple example, LED, the TV used to be how much initially, now is huge, home theaters coming up, bar, small used to be, now how many bottles, it's like a restaurant, you know, home. Yeah. So we are adding all this stuff, and this is the part and parcel of this. That's the reason we always say go into the passive measure which are going to be there in this building, go into more on focus on a passive measure where you have a fantastic compartmentation and egress which require to be connected logically. That's the best way to go ahead to take care of anything which is in
I just wanted to add that you're talking about high rise. I think that now with all the new technology and new materials which are coming in the market, it's very good, because you're all bothered about, you're all concerned that the building should look beautiful, the city should look beautiful. But I just wanted to voice one concern that all these materials, it's very important to know how the implementation of these materials is done in the building, because these materials might be fireproof and, you know, they have all the right standards, everything, but if they are not fixed properly, you know, they will be actually not serve the purpose, and in fact they will add
propellants to,
yes,
to the
like fire. For example, you know, I have done commercial buildings, and I've always found, I mean, whenever I do one, okay, the first thing I will ask the consultant, the facade consultant, show me your smoke seal detail. Like, you know, it's a very simple thing. It's just that when you are cladding a building from outside, okay, there is a certain gap between the slab and the facade, which is about 100 mm. How is that sealed? I mean, is it sealed properly? And even if it is sealed, does anybody actually go on site to see how that work is being done? Because if there is smoke, it just travels from one floor to the other, and it's a killer. So I think, like, along with technology, I think there has to be some way where, you know, somebody, some body will come and make sure that it has been done in the right fashion.
I completely agree with you. In fact, another question and another thought has always been that we do a lot of things on paper. Our facade consultants do a lot of things on paper. We do a lot of vetting of the shop drawings before something is executed. But the question is, how has it been executed? And do we have some standards in place to kind of cross verify these? And can we actually have someone certify this? So that would kind of raise the bar a little bit. And also maybe can we look at materials which you know have better specifications in terms of at least not propagating fire. Any thoughts on materials?
Materiality point of view, there are two things to it. So basically, as you rightly said, no building by default. So 50,000 square feet floor plate cannot be dangerous, right? If it is being planned for, let's say, an occupancy of, say, 75 square feet per person, so probably, so there would be probably somewhere out of 50 square feet per person. So there would be that desired number of population. You would plan the toilets accordingly, you would plan the egress accordingly, and stuff like that. What happens is, the kind of functions those get kind of installed within those larger footprints in terms of the compartmentalizations that you do and the way, you know, people need to understand. So for example, a lot of corporate IT companies nowadays are going to the concept of offshore delivery center, which are in multiple of 40, 50, 60 right. people in one room. Now, you know, it was interesting that once I had to tell a client that if you are exceeding the number of 40, you need to provide two means of egresses from the same room.
Right.
So, and all they're excited about is, what is it that the maximum number of people that you can fit on the floor? I said, no. What is it that the optimum or the safe? So as an approach, what we've done is, whenever we actually start the plan, now I'm not talking about architecture, I'm talking more from a large interiors, and that becomes even more dangerous because sometimes on one floor, there are more than 1,500 people sitting. So imagine,
this is inside out experience
eventually, and that basically must shape the core of the building and then eventually the facade and the form of the building.
Absolutely.
So basically, understanding the fact that telling the client based on the width of the egress routes or based on the weights of the staircases, this is what the maximum permissible occupancy that you have in terms of 1.5 minute, 2 minutes or whatever it is, you take a call. Secondly, in terms of the materiality, obviously using materials which are obviously certified as, you know, whatever, you know, ASTM 84 or E84 or whatever they can be, they definitely should not add to the cause of fire. So carpets nowadays are, you know, coming in those specifications. The gypsum sheets are coming in those specifications. The glass basically withstand that. Most of the server room, UPS room, which are a larger hazard of fire, are actually created using, 2-hour enclosure. Where people forget, and most common mistake in terms of the cause of fire is, the crossings between these partitions, you know, contractors typically take the liberty to drill the holes in the wall and don't, you know, make sure that they have to be, you know, fire stopped using, you know, the right foam materials and stuff like that. So these are the small things, because once it goes above the ceiling, you cannot even ascertain whether or not it is done, and the office looks fancy, beautiful, but how it performs in the case of such situation. Very interesting point that you mentioned, you know, in terms of visualizer, in terms of ensuring whether or not what you have designed and whether or not what you are specifying is performing to that level.
Yeah.
So in interiors, to ensure that, we basically carry out the analysis called as cause and effect matrix before we actually give an occupancy to the client. So it basically simulates the whole exercise, you know, in terms of, let's say somebody breaks the manual call point. this should happen. One event should trigger another 3, 4, 5, 6. If something should happen, you know, my fire alarm should basically pick up a signal. My response indicator should show that. My zone indicator should show that. It should trigger all my access control doors to come open. It should trigger my fire dampers to shut down. So these are the cause and effect matrix, and we actually do a larger kind of a sample field to analyze whether or not this actually is taking place. And this has kind of given our clients a phenomenal amount of comfort and actually, you know, kept the building ready on its own specifications to actually prevent fire one and then fight if the need be. So that's the change. Yeah, rather than the react.
Yeah, I think keeping a building ready to fight fire is very important, and that brings us to things like facade maintenance and the audits that we were touching upon. Also, if you kind of want to take that a step forward in terms of certification, maybe it would be a good exercise over the next maybe few months if we can, as a community, come together and understand which are the typologies or laboratories which we should be following, and their stamps and certifications we should be following in terms of fire safety. Can you throw some light onto that in terms of
basically, I think that's typically good. So I think internationally you would have most of the materials or most of the processes which are UL certified. Yeah, under ITER laboratories, that's the biggest name in terms of the global benchmark. But probably part of my experience, ignorance, but then the awareness that the environmental parameters have taken, so like people take pride in, you know, LEED Gold or LEED Platinum or IGBC Gold or IGBC Platinum certification for making building environmentally sustainable, we should be able to proudly wear a similar sort of a badge on our labels, or, you know, the building's lobby saying that this building is compliant to this XYZ kind of a norm. So I think, Doctor, I think, you know, this is something. You know, it would also see nowadays basically people would like to flaunt, be it your environmental awareness or be it your safety awareness. So something like that, if there is a collateral benefit in building, then so that's one big chunk of real estate off your shoulders, sir, in terms of the responsibility. So I think definitely something like that coming across in a very structured format would be a definitely welcome exercise. I definitely would happy to contribute if something were to, you know, come up with this particular manner.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, good comments there. Could we just break this open very quickly, because Dr. Rangdale has to leave. If there is anyone from the audience before we close this discussion who has questions for the panel, and especially Dr. Rangdale.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is to Mr. Rangdale. I'm a representative of the Afternoon Dispatch newspaper. Say for instance, if I'm residing in a building and I know there are flaws in terms of structural designs and fire safety norms have been clearly flouted, and there are no exit routes that have been properly charted out at the time of making the building, and if I know that a few people from the building are hand in glove involved with the officials, and this could potentially pose a threat. So then what can I do if I have to make a complaint and these guys are probably hand in glove and acting in connivance and resorting to corrupt means, then who can I complain to?
No, it is not happening. Nobody takes it as far as the officials are concerned. You give the complaint, you have proof. See, there are two segments which are really, 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 there are real honest one and there are unhonest complaints, okay? But in the last 3 years, there's not a single incident wherein I never got the complaint stating that look, we made the complaint, and the complaint reports, okay, which was getting generated by us, it can be accessible, it is now, it can be accessible by anybody, okay. That complaint report is with the whatever correct practice, okay? The issue is nobody understand. The issue is, like I'll give a best example, okay? The act, okay? The act say, if I go and if there are some compliance required, it you require to give some days to him, like 120 days. During my whole, like, you know, we have inspected more than how many buildings? I think in 3 months it is, sorry, 4 months, sorry, 6 months, more than 5,000 buildings be inspected. 57 prosecution was there. More than a half of the building got the notice. Okay? And they complied it. But what happened, after another 6 months, if I go there, the compliance will be not there. How do you expect? There's no fire service in the world where all fire officials will be on a, in each of the building, going there and inspecting the building. There's required to be self-certification. And that's the provision in law. So there are some intricacies. What happened? If I, you, like there's one complaint made, okay, refuse liya, ko aisa aisa kar diya. I have to give him a time. I'm not a dictator. Just go and, you know, arrest him or something like that. I have to give him a 30 days, 40 days, whatever. And he has to comply with. So you can complain anytime. As far as your own complaint is concerned, you can come directly. You have my number now. Okay. But in general, there is a complaint redressal system within our system. And in fact, it is surprising, rather, it's only verbally said like this. We corrupt actually say it. I to always tell, like, come with a proof to me. Okay, this corrupt practice, prove it. Instantly there will be some justice, or instantly there will be a reaction from our side. So that is what the way we are doing it. Because see, listen, rightly said, I don't want to come here as a fireman. I want to come here for a cappuccino. Because definitely, because if I come, I'm coming here as a fireman, that means you are in problem. Your safety is in problem. Something is wrong, okay? And I don't want it to be wrong. So definitely, I don't see any fire officer doing something like this, okay? As far as my department is concerned. I think that's...
Sir, one more question. Sir, for the mutual benefit of everyone present here, like you, at the start you said that we are the cause of problems and we are giving rise. Like you said, have less whiskey bottles at home. Something of that sort, basically. So, certain tips that you could give what people can practice at home for individual households that can at least try and keep those in mind and avoid fire-related incidents in future?
Everybody. If a child is born, he knows what is his safety parameters. Everybody knows this. These are two factors which work against this, is negligence and deliberation. Yeah. That's the reason we require to have awareness. That's the reason we are putting like no program. That, see, I don't say that because of my own strategy. You bet na gadi ke liye. मैंने इतना ये कर लिया इसके लिए कॉल ड्रॉप हो रहा है आई एम सेइंग दैट द डे वी स्टार्टेड विद द अवेयरनेस प्रोग्राम द डे वी स्टार्टेड विद द वॉलंटियर प्रोग्राम दिस ह्यूज डिफरेंस सी आपने 3 साल पहले फायर सर्विस का इतना विजिबिलिटी देखा ही होगा ओके नाउ वी आर विजिबल नाउ नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ फायर बट बिकॉज ऑफ गुड रीजन वी पुट रणदीप हुड्डा वी पुट अमिताभ बच्चन जी ऑन बोर्ड व्हाई The reason is the visibility required. So one, when you see every time, so see, definitely in this, what are the crowd we have, okay? Thoda bahut to awareness aa gaya hoga. Understand? And it's a very simple thing, like, you know, your staircase, your whatever, store room, logically, it should be, no, there should not be no encroachment or something like that. Even a small and a simple thing you do in your life.
It is very important, that makes a difference. I think that. Okay, just one last question.
Yeah. Hello. Sir, एक small doubt and small question भी है. अभी 50% are the new buildings which are coming in Mumbai, where we are following the safety norms and every sprinkler systems, but the purana building है 20 साल 30 साल पहले जहाँ पे मैंने पहले एक rented house में भी था जहाँ पे sprinkler system भी नहीं था वहाँ पे नहीं था कुछ भी नहीं था तो उन buildings के लिए आप क्या action ले रहे हैं I just want to know the 50% I mean
not 50% is more than 70%
you can say
more than 80%. What you see in high-rise, bada-bada building, if you see in Parel area, there are hardly how many buildings which are visible, okay? Which are not visible are non-high-rise, okay? So the maybe if you think about the land use and if you think about the construction area, I'm not talking about Jhuggis, the 60% land is occupied by the Jhuggis, 40% land chunk what we have now at present, out of that only maybe a 5% what you are talking about the new buildings and all other buildings, that is 95% are old building, okay? Now see, listen, kya kar sakta hu? बट वॉट वी कैन डू इज लाइक नो जो जूना चीज है जो उनको अभी लाइक नो देर इज देर आर बिल्डिंग इन नरीमन पॉइंट एरिया देर आर बिल्डिंग इन नरीमन पॉइंट एरिया विच आर मोर देन डेकेड्स ओल्ड एंड वेयर द एनबीसी वाज नॉट देयर यू नो हाउ द एनबीसी केम इन टू कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन. Anybody know? SBI fire, State Bank of India, where firemen also died. So I don't know the exact year. So what happened? Still, what we do now, this is one thing what we do is, how to implement, we are also very clever guys, okay? Now this is an old building. That building doesn't have any of the fire standard. We give them a minimum requirement, and when we give the minimum requirement, my recommendations are fresh, so they come into purview of act. That's the way we are doing it.
I have a suggestion for that. Can I? अभी तो digital India हो चुका है, so can you make it? अभी सब जगह societies है, so can you tell them कि you have to do this? मतलब अभी जो मेरा building था, एक पुराना building है, 20 साल पुराना है. हमारे एक सोसाइटी है, उनको आप हर एक सोसाइटी को आप एक बता सकते हैं कि मिनिमम फायर रिक्वायरमेंट्स ये सब करना ही पड़ेगा विद द कॉस्ट ऑफ द फ्लैट पर्सन. सो आपका जो 2 साल में जो काम होने वाला है वो 6 महीने में खत्म हो जाएगा एंड आपका उतना टेंशन नहीं रहेगा. मे बी
ऑलरेडी वी आर डूइंग इट.
आई डोंट थिंक सो, बट
दैट इज फॉर दैट इनिशिएटिव ओनली. वी आर गोइंग टू हैव ऑल कोलैटरल्स ऑफ द बिल्डिंग एंड ऑटोमेटिकली डंडा मिलने वाला है. It means every 6 months you will be going to have your SMS and alert and email alerts. And I think as far as the old buildings, those who are not in parameter of our law, like you know, 15 meters, we have a high-rise building which has came up to 24 meters, not in 33 meters, okay? 33 meters, ये वहाँ तो अपना high-rise का definition चालू होता है. The reason is that kind of infrastructure what we have for fighting the fire, okay? So, most of the building, those who are with us, and that is what constitutes large chunk of the building, they are going to be monitored by our system.
Just a picture release होता है तो फिर उतना सारे banners, posters. So why can't you मतलब
keep? You should come and you know join us. The reason is very easy to say, like you know, we are putting the banners, we are putting lot of awareness program. Huge awareness program. He is also one of my friend. You can ask him after he, I go.
In my 10 years tenure,
I would just want to step in here. I think at this point we've exceeded the time of the panel discussion. We'll close the discussion at this point. Thanks a lot, guys. Thanks a lot, Dr. Angale. Thanks a lot, Mr. Boregaonkar. Thanks a lot, Mr. Libere. Yeah.